I suppose we can start now. So welcome everybody, and thank you for attending this this workshop, which will be a purpose for efficient reproducibility in R. So we would like to provide a sort of journey from patchwork to project. What does it mean? So first of all, something about me. I'm Corrado Lanera. I'm working at the Unit of Biostatistics, Epidemiology and Public Health at the University of Padova in Italy. And I work with R since 2014. And these are my contacts. So you can write me or reach me at your convenience for any question about the material or other. So with me there is Andrea Pedò. I don't know if you want to Andrea, if you want to present yourself.
So I'm a young medical doctor. I'm working with Corrado at the same unit of biostatistics epidemiology. And I'm collaborating on him first on a couple of projects about mechanical ventilation and artificial intelligence. And now we are working on some of the projects of the unit.
Okay. So some words about this workshop. There are the slide. You can find the slide online at the URL I reported here, and I reported also in the chat, so you can explore them. For questions, you can use the question and answer facility of Zoom, and Andrea will manage the question, and in any case you can interrupt me anytime. Also you can ask some question at any time if you want to speak directly. So you can choose if you prefer to write questions or ask them directly. There are two ways in which you can follow the workshop. One is on your local machine. At the any stage, the workshop will be one stage after another, and I will create with you a single project from the beginning to the end. But at every stage, there are a snapshot of a sort of snapshot of the project. Clearly, I create it live with you, so maybe there could be some difference. But at every stage, you can restart from a similar or equivalent project using this line of code, filling the stage name with the appropriate one. Also, if you don't want to run them locally, there is also a PostCloud workspace that has inside all the project, so you can simply go to this link and start with one of them that we go through the materials. Clearly, for PostCloud workspace, you need a free PostCloud account, and I don't know if there are someone of you that would like to use this resource that does not have a PostCloud account, but it is a free account, and by this link you go directly inside a workspace in which you will find all those projects, and you can use any one of them. It will be not super powerful, but it is free for you. Also, if you like to explore the whole project, this is the GitHub link to the repository, in which you can find all the materials, all the slides, all the links to the staged project we will use. Okay, so after this initial setup, we will start with an introduction that will be mainly by slides, and next we have a little discussion about how is our vision of the pipeline to set up a project or to develop incrementally a project, and next we start a step by step project development, starting from a cleaner project, but follow all these stages, motivating time after time why we could need some of these functionalities. So at the end, we will just show you a template that it is available, that we develop, that incorporate all the functionalities that we highlighted, with someone more that we explain to you. Okay, so and so we conclude with some recapitulation of summary of what we have done. Okay, so I don't know if there are some questions about how to follow the workshop, or okay. Moment, I don't know why. Okay. Okay. Okay, so we will start with an introduction on just a little maybe funny or already known story of what as soon as possible mean when we develop a project. So usually when someone asks us for a project, for some analysis, they always need they are ready as soon as possible. So we started of getting the raw data, and maybe if they have something that is not perfectly right, we directly fix them inside the raw data, and next we start doing the analysis. So after some moment, maybe we get some updated data that they overwrite the previous one, and we need to again to fix the old fixes that we made, and maybe there are some more to fix, and maybe possibly we don't know if we have forgotten someone, but we need at this time to to update the analysis, and this could mean to overwrite them, or maybe just to save space or to have a backup. We made a copy of our old analysis, and we renamed the current one as a version 2 of our script. But after some time, we find some bug and we fix them, and so we save a third version of our script that can be named analysis version 2. Okay. And also we find that because it is the third run of our analysis, some computation are quite slow, and so we try to rewrite them with some exploration, and we pass a few hours to make our script something quicker, and we save another version of our script. So at the end of the day, we send our report that we hope it is correct just before the deadline, that as anyone know, the real mean of as soon as possible is yesterday. So the problem is that sometime after that, our boss returned to us to say that they have found a bug, and just for this workshop, I call it a box. So that is something like a bug that is reported by the one who asks us to provide the analysis after we give them our results. So we decide to not give up with the analysis, and during the night time, paying attention to not falling asleep, so with many coffee, etc., we code and code and code, and finally we create many versions of our files. We have many names in our scripts. We create a new version of plots, new fixes, and after all this work, we sent our revision. But we wait some, and at the end, our boss returned to us with another box. So they decide to make them doing to another one. So they switch the project from us to another analyst, and they started to do quite the same thing we did yesterday, but even faster, because now it must be as soon as possible. So the problem is that the other people cannot understand quite anything of our work, and clearly is not our issues. And so they prefer to restart from scratch because it is easier and faster. So they also add other folders, other files, other version of those files, other plot, and other fixes to the project. So just in time, as we did yesterday, they sent the project, but finally also them find a bug. So the boss this time understand that it would be better to make the analysis by themselves. And so the problem is that they don't recognize where to find the data, where the analysis are inside the scripts. And so at the end of the day, nowadays, they try to ask some help from the main provider of solution today. And but the answer, as we can read, also relay in a template that should be filled with analysis and everything. And this is the end of this little story. And I don't know how many of you have similar experience. I work with analysis and other people, and we are working with the clinical data, and medical doctors always have urgencies, always need something, and the analysis made by yesterday. And so this pattern, so I saw this pattern or some variation of this pattern many times. So what can we do? So we say, okay, we are good R programmer, and depending on what is your point of view, I hope to not be too much so that this opinion is not always shared by anyone, but maybe you can decide to go with the tidyverse and hope that with tidyverse everything should be good, and this pattern will not be repeated anymore. The issues, what is not the structure of the tidyverse. I think that quite every one of you have seen this chart before, but the problem with what happened in our story is the hidden part of this chart. So the problem is that the raw data that you will import, maybe they can change with the new data. And the problem is that maybe those data should be kept private, because maybe you cannot share them, but maybe you should need to share the code for your analysis without sharing the data. The problem that you can find bugs with function, so even your function could change, and maybe other people can ask you to change the function, or if you are not a single developer, maybe other developers in the same project can change the function. For the visualization, they can require updates, and when you create a model, also the model need to be updated or fixed, and maybe they are not only showed on our console with some results, but they should be used in a real environment in production, and maybe they should be validated by someone else, and maybe when you provide a report, you don't need to simply create a report that have some evidence that you do the thing in the correct way, but maybe someone would ask you to have the ability to reproduce maybe your results, and if is one of your collaborator or maybe your boss, so someone that have actually access to your private data, they should be allowed to effectively execute your code and your pipeline to create your final results from the raw data. On the side of all of that, also all of this is made by program, and maybe if you are using R, maybe you are using some packages, and also packages can be updated. And I don't know how many of you have had issues with package update, maybe since the sending of the analysis and the requirement for a revision, maybe 6 months later, or you make a project in pause and you restart with it 2 years later, or maybe someone else restart or continue the project 2 years later, and all the packages are different, and you cannot recreate which package it was used in the project. And so, as we know in our story, in the last story, it was simpler and faster, and maybe with a similar outcome to restart everything from scratch. So the main issues here is that there is something hidden in the chart, that is the time. So time can change the data, can change the function, can change the report, the environment, the object, and also the people working with the project. So the main issues here is facing the problem that when we create an analysis, so when we conduct a project, we should not think a project has a static object that we develop, but we need to consider time. And when we hear from our bosses, made it as soon as possible, the problem is to have results in less time as possible. So the point here is centered in this sentence. So don't waste time. But the problem with don't waste time is another question. So whose time? It's your time that you need don't waste. My time, maybe, if you consider me an expert to ask some suggestion or to fix something, or maybe the people you are asking help in Stack Overflow or someone else, or you don't need to waste your boss time, which time you have to save. So in my opinion, when someone asks you to do something as soon as possible, you have to save the project time. And for us, the project time is the sum of all the iteration you made until you have a correct version of your analysis. And each iteration is the sum across all the people in your team that are involved in the project, and for every one of them, the time they spend on every task it is required to get the end of the project. And you should need to include breaks, because you can ask yourself to don't sleep one night, maybe, if you want to risk to make something wrong. But even if you are able to be asleep, to not fall asleep for one time, and maybe maintain the concentration for a single night, you definitely cannot avoid to sleep for a week or for a month or maybe for more than 1 or 2 days, but I think that just more than 2 days, 1 day is more than enough to have the guarantee that even if you are awake, your program skill touch the ground of zero level quite fast. So if you don't focus on as soon but to as possible, what we can to have a definition of as soon as possible is the collection of the set of all the strategies that you can adopt and you can implement to minimize the overall project time. So the first things that I have learned in my experience is to start slow, because even if you want to have the perfect project, not all the perfect project need the same level of complexity, or not every project need a great structure of control and development. Maybe you have to run a single line script and you even didn't need to create an overall project. So the suggestion is to start slow. And what does it mean? It means that if you need something, do it, but don't do things that you don't need it. So because if you do something that you think you need but you don't really need, this could waste your time for two main reasons. One is that there are some possibility that this functionality will be never used, so it is a poor waste of time because it will never be used by anyone, neither by you. But there is another option that you anticipate a different needs. So you provide a solution that is a wrong solution to a similar problem that will happen. So it is not only a waste of time because something you have implemented will not be used. But maybe you have to fix it to make actually run in the correct way when you need it. But if you go to with these strategies, you have to also to start slowly, but keeping in mind that you need to prepare your project and yourself to add features, to add new components. So you need to start to think about a project, maybe even if it is a single file project, keeping in mind that there is the possibility that that tomorrow it will become maybe a greater project, or maybe your team will become not only made by you, but maybe by two people, not only you. So, in this workshop, our aim is to step by step develop a project, starting from scratch to a project that to a project structure that we think could be quite robust and reproducible, and maybe that can be easily understandable by other people and other collaborators, and that it is as easy as possible to be fixed if some bug is discovered, and also that can kept private data with within your project, keeping the option to share all your code in a way that it is easily executable by someone that have access to the data, but clearly it cannot be run by someone that cannot have access to the data, but anyone can read it and explore it. So just one warning. So clearly we have an order in our journey to this project. We make some choice with the tools that we use within this project, but keep in mind the first objective. So if you need it, do it, and only if you need it. So you can change the order accordingly to your need on your next project, and you can change tools maybe if they are improved or if you prefer to use other tools. I try to provide some basic usage of the tools we have chosen, but this workshop is not about those tools. So for many tools, we don't explain how they work or how can you become good at using those tools. And my suggestion is to start maybe to use them and clearly study them, but maybe even more important to use them. So even before to start to study them. So this is really a learning by doing and by experience, and you have you create your opinion about which tool is better. So maybe you completely disagree with our choices of the tools we presented, and you would like to use completely different tools. You are free to think about that. The only thing is to try to start to think a project as something that has stages and is something that live a long time, and that the time will change the project, and you should be prepare yourself and all the people all of your team, maybe of your future team, that people you don't know, to understand what you have done as quickly as possible and as clear and as possible. Okay, so we can start. So please, you can switch on your microphone if you want to interrupt me at any time. Use the question and answer to put any question you need, and so we can start with the creation of a project. If you would like to have a ready to use bare project, you can run this line of code or go in the same project on Posit Cloud. Okay, so the first step in creating a project is to have a project, and so start to think about your analysis as a project, and so create a box, so in this case a folder, in which to put maybe all you developed about that project. You can create a project with our studio that it will be our choice during this this workshop. But one of the main point is that your project should be independent on the position in which it is. And in R, the package here is extremely useful to reach every position inside a project folder, starting from the root of the project folder. So in this sense, we will use here to be independent on the absolute path of our project, so to explore files within the subfolder independently on where the folder can move around our computer, or maybe on other computer if we share our project with someone other. After that, that is simply one of our personal choices and standards. We use a setup R script just to track the code we progressively run to create our project, just both to have the to don't lose them, maybe to explore for a next project, or to have a ready to use draft of the stage we already did in the past, but also to make some other that could be interested in how we have developed our project, maybe to help us in this development, or maybe to try to use our strategies in their project. After that, we will use RM in our project. That is a package that create a sort of local library of packages inside our project, and using a very smart caches, it is lightning fast to restore the exact same version of the packages we used in our project in future execution, and also in the execution of different system. Maybe I use Windows, one of my colleagues use Macintosh or some other operating system, Linux or other. And within a lightweight files and structure that don't need to share the complete packages folders, we can recreate the exact environment in which we have developed and run our project. After that, we can also activate Git in our project. That it is an engine that track the version of our scripts and in general of text files, and it can be used to keep track of changes that we made during the time that passed while we develop our project, and also can help don't waste time or space in exploration, because as soon as we create a snapshot of our project, we can completely delete code that are outdated, because we will not lose them, because we maintain it in our history. So it allows us to make more exploration, more experiment on and keeping track of them, because many times we start to or at least in my experience, I start to try some ways on implementing a solution or some other ways of implementing another solution, and I have lost in the past those experiments because they are not tracked, and I had a lot of files at they create a lot of confusion in my mind, so I start to delete all files just to find that I deleted the wrong files I have implemented maybe a very smart solution that I have lost and I cannot restore them. With Git, we save all of that, and also we can use GitHub or other some similar platform to host online projects that are tracked by Git, so that also all our collaborators can have access to every stages of the development and can very efficiently contribute to it, keeping track of changes or updated. Okay, so after we will create the first structure, we can suppose we need to have some analysis and also provide some report to maybe our boss or some other, or maybe to write a paper with the analysis. So we can start creating an analysis script and separate R Markdown document. Now you can use also Quarto. We will not talk about it. There are other workshop of or talks in this R Medicine that you can follow to explore how
wonderful. Corrado, we have a question on the chat. Okay. If you can make a quick remark on the chat.
Oh, I'm not sure how what you intend with the industry related, but in this environment is simply so it's not an environment. We create a sort of a folder that contain all our project. We will stop at this level. The main issues that we don't talk about the level we miss, but the main issues that we won't touch is related to the R itself. So at least so we not talk about all the system configuration we simply stopped our solution in encapsulating the project the packages level structure. So yes. Git is Git is local. So Git is an engine like R, and it keep track of your project. So you can use with your local project without any issues. GitHub is an online platform that hosts Git project and provide services and utilities for managing and deploying those projects also. But there are other platforms. There are maybe on-premises solution that you can implement that use ways to host that you can host Git project. Okay. The first issues here is that when we have analysis and report, we have a problem that we have to our input data, and we need to know where to put them and how to reach them and where to put our output files. Okay, so we can start with the first stage. I will also create the project, but if you prefer, you can start from the paid one we provided. Okay, so can you see all my screen or only the slide were shared?
Yep.
Okay, perfect. So we can create a new project clicking here in the new project button, or in files new project, or here new project, as you prefer. And we can start with a new directory. Maybe we are starting our project, and we can give a name to the project we are developing, maybe reproach. And so within RStudio, it is really easy to attach Git and RMV functionalities to our project because they are we can easily embed them in our project just to put those two things. Okay, so we can create our project. Oh yes. This is okay, or maybe I need to increase more. Okay, perfect. Okay, so just to explore our starting project folder structures, we have something related to Git that for the moment we can ignore. We have our files and folder related to the things that our project is an RStudio project, So we explain those four files. And also we have our RMV structure, that is, it is composed by a sort of list of packages and that we use in our project, and a folder containing some files, but mainly the local version, the local library, the local library for our project. So as you can see, we have our version of R for my system here, and inside we have the architecture and the list of packages we have. So as you can see, those two things are now aligned. So we have only the R in version 4.3.0, and we have only the RMV packages, and I have only the RMV packages in inside my local library. After that, we see that we have also an R profile files for if someone of you don't know what is the R profile. R profile is an R script that is run just before that you have access to your actual R environment, and it is something that is that will be executed when you activate, when you start, every time you restart or start your project, or you open your R session inside the project. This script is run just before you can have access to the project and R itself. So as you can see, the main things that it is done here is to execute the activation of RMV environment and facilities inside your project. And for the moment, this is the only thing that our project do to prepare the project for us to be used. Okay, another thing that that it is important is that with the RMV, mainly you need only to remember mainly only a single command, or maybe three, but maybe a single one, that is the status one. So RMV status. I need this time to explicitly name the package I would like to use the function, and with the double column I access to the function that are inside the package, and so I can execute exactly the function status inside the RMV package. So maybe everyone you need to do about RMV is suggested by RMV itself to you. So maybe you don't need to remember quite anything. If you want to remember one function, remember this one, that is mainly the only one you need to remember. Everything you need to do, RMV will suggest you to do it, explaining even how to do it. Okay, so we can start creating our first script that we can save in naming it 00 setup, just to keep track of what we did of what we did in to create our project. So the first thing we can do is to activate and include some package that we can use to help us in developing our project. So maybe the first option could be to start to install packages, and we can use the DevTools package. But the issues with this line of code is that if we already have this package, we unusefully install it again and again and again. And also, if we provide this project to someone other, we force the installation of this package in another one system. That is not a good option, because maybe we can break some other code updating possibly the package. Using RAMP, this is quite mitigated, because we are involving only the local library of packages, so we cannot hurt external packages from our project. But anyway, one option is to try to ask the people to install the package, and only if it is needed. So we can start with an if, no, require namespace DevTools, for example. Okay. And we can ask if we want to effectively install our package. So, okay, and we by default answer false, and if both the condition are matched, we can effectively install our packages. This way we can run this little snippet and ask us if we would like to install the DevTools only if we don't have it inside our local environment. So we can say yes, and if we don't like to install them for any reason, we have the option to say no. I forgot, sorry. Okay, I think that as you can see in my system, the installation of DevTools that required quite a lot of packages is very fast, and this is because quite all of them are already inside the cache in my computer. So the very first time you install a specific version of a package, clearly all the installation must be done by your system. But after that, even in new projects, if you use RAND and you use the same version of the package, you need just the time to make RAND link to its cache. So now, as you can see, inside our local library, We have all our package, all our packages here. But this time, in our RM block file, we don't have them. In fact, those two things are should be synchronized, and we always have the option to decide which is the updated one. So there are three options, or the packages we have installed are the same of the packages that we want to have inside our project, that are the ones listed in the RM block file, or our library is outdated, so we have to restore the environment following the instruction provided by the RM block directives, or maybe, as in this case, our library is updated and we need to update our list of packages that are used in our project. So we can use RM status for that, and as you can see, RM now say that we have installed some package, but that they are not recorded in the log file, and it already suggests us to run this function to add this package in the log file if we would like. So we can run it, and now again RMV explain us exactly what it is going to do. So it is going to change the no version of a package with the asterisk with a specific version of those packages. So we can say yes, and we have simply updated now our RM block with the specification of the description of every package with their version, and also the exact hash of encoding of the exact version of our packages, because even if the developer is not a very good developer and change the version without changing its number, this code will definitely change. So we need we know that so RMV know that exactly which package you need inside your project. Okay, so after that, we can start to create our two scripts, and so we can create the script for our analysis. And we can create also the R markdown file for our report. We need other packages, as RStudio asks us. Okay, and we simply say report. Okay. Okay, so here is our basic repo. We can save it with the name repo. Okay, and we can clear all the content, just keeping our the structure. Okay, so here, maybe we have said that we would like to use the package here. And Maybe we would like to use the package the tidyverse, for example. But as you can see, we need to install them because we doesn't have inside. So even if you have those packages in your system, inside this project, there is no package called tidyverse or maybe here. So we need to install them. But what happened that often you made some copy paste and say, okay, this is here and this is here and this is here. So just keep in mind that you are using some times to change every occurrence of the package name with the updated one. But maybe you can do some error in this copy pasting execution. So we can avoid this kind of repetition, and we can start to use some function. So we can install, for example. Now we can copy paste this content, for example, and here we can put the package, and here package. Okay, and here we can put the package. So this way we have created a function that automatically do all the job for us. And so we simply need to please install DevTools and with a single copy here. Tidyverse. Okay, just keep look at this dot. This is only a sort of a way to keep a name hidden. So if you look at the environment, if I have a variable eight, this is appear here, but if I have something name starting with a dot, it cannot appear. It didn't appear it here, but we have it, so we can run this, and clearly it doesn't ask us to install DevTools because we already have installed it. But with here that we don't have now, it asks to install. So yes. Oh, and as you can see, I don't know if you have seen the prompt. I have made a mistake because I've put the comma here. So also I gained the option to correct this in a single place, and all my functionalities will be automatically updated. So I can also install the tidyverse. Oh, I missed the space now, so maybe cancel. Okay. Okay. Okay, so as you can see, now we have inside our library the package here. Here, but it is not inside our RM block. Okay. So we can also, we already know that we have updated it. So we can also put here our RAM status to check the status of our project. And as we already know, we need to have a snapshot of the project. So we can also put that here, whoever. Just there, ready. Okay, yes. Okay, so now we can go with our analysis. Maybe we can restart our session to have a clean environment to work. You can do it pressing Control. F10. So Control Shift F10, and you automatically restart your session. So maybe we can start to read some data, but the problem here, okay, we have created our analysis, we have created a sort of report. But okay. But now we need to. Okay. But now we need a place to put our data and our output. So. Our suggestion is to create different folders. So one for the raw data and maybe one for the actual data that we processed and one for the output we create. So this way we can now put here some data. We can create we can use the Palmer Penguins data just to have an example. So to do that we also need the Palmer Penguins package. Okay. Oh, yes, we need to create this function. Okay, and so now we can. We can use our the raw data inside this package, and because we have already the tidyverse, we can use the reader function to write. Then inside our data folder. Okay, this way we get the data inside here. So suppose to have your data, to have your data here, and now we can read our data from our analysis script. So we can import our DB row. And load our packages. Okay, and next we can start. We have a little preprocessing of them. For example, penguins. We can define our object like DB row example, and maybe we would like to have a uniform naming, so we need also the package janitor. So we can put it here. Okay, so we can load now our package. So now we have access to the clean names, and next we can maybe select only some variables. This is just to simulate some preprocessing. Okay, and now when we have provide some preprocessing, we have to store our data somewhere, and we can store them inside the data folder. So we can write RDS, that is the R data serialization format. So we have a sort of file that encode in the R way our data, while CSV is a text format, so you can view it, and it is simply a text file nicely formatted. RDS is quite a same object, but it is not in a textual language, but in a sort of an R language that we cannot read, but R understand. And so it keeps all the structure of our object or the levels of our factors, etc. So we can put penguins and put it here. Data. So just to provide a parenthesis, I execute all the consecutive line of code that create a single command with control or command return, and you execute all the block of code that create a single chain of command. So with write RDS now, I have my data here. And just a small parenthesis, the main difference with RDS and RDA that you possibly have seen if you use the save workspace function, or if you have the dot are you can see here, you have the .r data that I suggest you to never save and never restore. But the main difference in those two kind of objects is that the RDS file is a single file, is a single object that is stored in a way that R can understand and can store all the structure of that object. But you have to think about it like a single object, so like a CSV. So R should read this object and you can name it as you prefer. So you have to put a name on this object when you read it, exactly as here. When you read a CSV, you have to put a name on the object that you have read. While an RDA is a sort of a box that in which you put our object, and our object are their own name. So when you load an RDA file, you recreate. So it is like a zip file. So you extract those objects from the RDA box and you put it inside the environment. This is quite dangerous because if inside the RDA box there is an object that has a name that it is equal of an object that you already have in a global environment, you overwrite your object without even knowing. So so think about this as a CSV and about this as a zip. So you have to read the RDS file and you have to load the RDA file. RDA, you extract and you take the object that are inside the box and put directly in your global environment. While with RDS, you have to read them and assign a name to the object that you have read. So just to answer your question, yes.
We have three questions after that one. So please finish to answer this question, then I will read you the others.
Okay. So I read these two questions. One is about here, and the other one is about the working directory of the project. Those are we can answer them in the same answer because we don't need to set the working directory because it is the R project itself, the R Studio project itself set its own working directory. While we put here, when we define our path, just because maybe this script should work even not in an R Studio project, maybe, and also as and also because maybe our script, our analysis script now is here in the main folder, but if we move the analysis from the root of our project inside another subfolder, maybe we would like to create a folder analysis because we have more than one script with the analysis and we would collect all those scripts inside the folder. We didn't need to change this line because the here always start the path from the root of our project. So we avoid the issues of thinking about where the analysis script is. So as soon as the The analysis script is somewhere inside our project. This part always work, also always will work. Okay, so there are another question.
Yes, you can see that in the Q&A section, and is what happens if I update any package, for example, okay. In Renv.
So for the package, there are is a very good question. So there are two type of packages in this sense. One type is the Renv package, and the other type is all the other packages. So clearly, so Renv can update the other packages, but it require some different ways to update itself. So we have two functions. One is Renv update that update all the packages. That are not Renv. And we have Renv upgrade that updates Renv. Okay. Anyway, my suggestion is to always start the project with the last updated packages, the most updated version of the packages, because they are the most updated, so the one with the less bug already known fixed, and there are the one that implement the last functionalities, and possibly there are the ones that keeping that will last during the time more in the future. But once you have started a project, the wonderful things of Renv that you don't need to update them. And my suggestion is that as soon as you have not finished a project, don't update your packages. So start with the most updated version of all the packages. But once you have started, always keep the same version of the packages to avoid collision between maybe some other people with that work with you and need to update them, or maybe some script that you have developed some weeks ago that work with inside your very same project. Maybe you have developed two scripts, one 2 weeks ago and one now, and they updated of the one package broke breaks the previous script. So start with the most updated version of the package and never update them until the end of the project, or if you don't need to do it because a very huge or important bug is discovered and fixed. Okay. So we have created our data, and we have stored a version of our data here. So now we can use those data to do something. So for example, we can do a plot. So make a plot. So for example, gplot. Okay, and we can put a smooth. And we have this in a particular way. And we can also have another smooth to highlight the difference. Of okay, you can put also some points for all those. And we can put a nice theme without the legend of the right, but on the top. Okay. And just to know the what I did, they automatically complete the command in RStudio. You can simply use the correct consecutive matching letters on your command. So for example, I can put legend and next I can go for pause and it doesn't matter what is in between. The only thing that counts is that this is the only command that have this sequence in this order. So we can be much faster using those tricks that writing code without spaces or all collapsed on that. So, okay, we can have our plot. You can see it, okay. And so we highlight that somewhere stratification counts. And we have to save this plot because we have to create our record. So this is save our plot in PNG. And we want to save our GG plot. And where to put here output. And we can put some configuration, example with it. 16, 9. Okay. So now we also have in our output, we have our plot that it is quite nice. Okay. And so after the plot, maybe we would like to have some analysis highlighting those two ways of get linear model results. So we can have model depth. Oh, I create the assignment operator correctly spaced with alt and the dash. So simply alt dash. Okay. And so linear model. G. Anyways, and we have to save also our model. So write RDS because it is an R object, mod depth here. With the tab, you complete also the path. Okay, and next we go with the stratified one, or maybe mob. Okay. Okay, and we also write okay, so we have our mod and our second model. Okay, so now we have all our analysis done. We are ready to go. Maybe we can provide some section on our script just to keep track of what is done. We can use control. R to use a section label, so for example packages, and we just have that, and here we can control shift R and then read and retro example, and here we can control shift R. Okay, and here we have the analysis. Okay, so now we have in this script we have our analysis. So and we have stored all our objects. So we have stored all our objects that are exactly the output of our analysis. So we can now start to create our record.
Corrado,
yes.
Sí. Once we finish this section, since we are already halfway through the workshop, maybe a 10-minute pause, like to freshen up everything and start back again.
Yes, of course. So just to finish this stage, here we need to create our record, but keep in mind that RMD is useful to create our analysis directly between our code and our description and text. But this way, we have to separate. We could separate our analysis from our report. But we can do this because we keep it all in the same project, and we use in our report the object that we create inside the analysis of the same project. This for the moment is quite a weakness of these strategies, but we will solve also this at the end. So we can use report. So maybe the following is temp. Okay. And now we can create our chunk that as we have here, we can use Control Alt E. Right. Sorry. Okay. And here we can have our path. So output. Clearly we need to load to attach our packages, so library here, because we have used here, and library Tidyverse. Okay, so we have our summary for our model, but that's a simple model. Show a negative. Okay. Control Shift I here. Out. I have the shortcut with the tab button. Tab. Inside here. Okay. So mod. Oh, sorry. Summary. And we have the other one that show the other relations. And as always, picture. Can here take our output and GG and need include graphics. So we have our picture. So we can knit our project, our report, and we have our report here with all the objects that we have created directly within our project in the analysis script, and we have saved in the output of folder of our project, so that if someone asks us for a high resolution images, or if we need to reuse our model, we don't need to fit again that, and we can use this in our report as many times as we want without needing to rerun everything. Okay, so at this point we can have a break. Inside the break, just start to think about what should happen if something changes. So what if some input changes? What if some output changes? And what if you are to repeat your code many, many times as we did it with for in our analysis, maybe for save our object that we use multiple times. So pretend to do it many times, or maybe similar plot many times. And what if you find bugs inside our code? Okay, so we can have a 10 minutes break. Just to answer the last question in the chat, yes, you can hide your code with the echo option. So if we set here to false, every code will be hidden, or if you can put here to have a global option and in a single chunk make the echo false to hide just this code from your. So if I commit this report, just I have the output without the code of the first chunk, while all the other ones have the default option, and so I have the code of those chunk as well. Okay, so 10 minutes break. Okay. We can restart. So suppose we have to something to change, or we have multiple instances of very similar functionalities that we would like to implement. And so, for example, we can take our analysis, for example, and say, okay, so maybe we would like to incorporate our storing function inside the function because maybe we would like to use different output, and we would like to be more flexible, but sure to what we do. So at the beginning, we can maybe start with a Control Shift R function session, and maybe we can start to extrapolate our repeated code inside the function. So for example, we can have a write object. We can function. We have our object and a name we want to provide for the object, and maybe a subfolder or a subdirectory inside our project to store the functionality. So maybe we have reader, right? RDS, our object here. We can use the glue that is already inside, already loaded, installed. We have name. RDS. With glue, we can include variable inside the curly braces, and we get the output. Pay only an attention that inside your analysis script is perfectly fine to use the function name directly without explicitly explain or declare the source packages, because it is a single script, and maybe you have restored your session many times, Control Shift F10, and it is quite fine and make the code more readable as well. But on the other side, inside the function, the suggestion is to be explicit about which function, which package a function is, because if you are not explicit about that, you can maybe overwrite the main functionality of a package, so a function of a package inside of your code. So just to have an example, just a very quick example, function what blue what? So now if I put my glue, I don't have the pet. So this is a first error. So I need to attach the package, but suppose I have attached it. Okay. So now it works, but Suppose that for some reason I redefine the glue function like this. So my glue now return two, because no one say to this glue that it should be the glue inside the glue package and not the my global environment glue. So inside the function, because I don't know where to I will use my function. I don't, so when I write my glue, I don't know what happened before. I don't know what other thing maybe create another name for the same object, because when I write my glue, I don't read with my eyes all the code that is inside. So maybe if here there are many lines, I don't know that this object is called inside this function. So inside function always be explicit about where to put where to take the function, in which package to take the function. Okay, so this is the reason why outside function I use directly the name, but inside function I keep the package name. Okay, so for example, from here, from the object, I can write maybe our output. So write output. And I create our object and name. And maybe we add bright object name, and in the folder output, and I can return the object so that I can use the function in a pipe, and maybe I can have write data function object name, and this is write object name inside data, and I will return my object. And also I can use maybe another for the plot. This is quite different. Function object name. I can use the last block. To use the same convention as ggsave. And now I can use my custom save. Create another so as you can see the where it is, so the ggsave function take the name before of the object, while all the other writing function will take the object before the name. So just inside our write function, we can create our custom function. That take the name and the object, and simply plot to ggsave name and object with our path. that is always output here. And we can also include our specification. Okay, and so that now we can custom save blue. And .png. And we can return the plot invisibly. Okay, so now we can have bright output or data. Penguins. Okay, but because we have returned the object and we take it as a first argument, we can also pipe it here. Okay. We can, after that, we can write our plot. So, write plot. G. Okay. And so, even here in the model, we have our bright output with the name mod depth. And also here we have bright output mod depth. Okay. Another issues rise here because maybe we say that what happens with if the source of our data change. Maybe all the analysis will change. So maybe we would like to automatically create all of this should be works, so we can Control Shift F10, restart everything. We can see how Renv have something to say. Okay, there are those packages that we didn't snapshot it, so we can snapshot them. Yes. Okay, Control Shift F10. Okay, so if we run, we don't need this anymore. If we run all of the script, Control A, select all, and Control return, run all in order. Everything should work. I write the wrong function here that doesn't exist, invisible, sorry. Okay, so Control Shift F10, Control All, Control Return. Okay, so let's say if the report is the same, we can knit it. Okay, we have our model and our plot, And if we say we look at that, we have the updated version the updated version of the object. But maybe we would like to keep track of all the version, maybe because when we provide a report, often when we update it, someone can ask us from the previous object. So what if we are asked to provide the previous model? So we can put here some version, maybe now is 1.0, for example, and we can add to a versioning on our function. So for example, version null that maybe is not provided, and we can check if not is null our version, we can output here, and we can use two, and we can use the dir slash name underscore version. So yes. And so we can either yes.
Corrado, note that you have a small typo in line 15 in the package name of Glue.
Oh, sorry. Thank you. Okay. Okay, so this way we have saved also a versioning name of our object, but we keep also save a standard unversioned name of our object. This way, our report will always call the same object with the same name, and always is the last updated object. But every time we update our analysis, we keep track of the actual object we use for this very analysis. So we have to update that because we need here the var null var, and also here. Okay, and maybe here. And also, it's not. Where custom say blue. PNG. Option. Oh, and also this is option. Okay, so now, as you can see, if I control shift F10, always restart your session to be sure that everything works. You can clean your console with CTRL plus L, and everything is clean. So we can here control all, control return. Oh, I didn't put the version in our saving. So there. Where? Where? Okay, Control Shift F10. As you can see, all the versions at the name and the object are saved and stored. And so we can here we can put our report. We can knit it, and it is still updated because all the naming are the last one. Okay, as we see in the function, this is highlight that we can read the code to highlight what we are doing. So try to extract maybe the logic of your analysis, maybe only in the preprocessing, for example. You can extract them in a function as well to keep track of what you are doing and keep maybe more easy to read your code. So just for example, we can put here a function preproc that getting input our raw data and do exactly that. In this way, we gain the first things I mentioned, so that now we simply say when we read our analysis, we simply say that we have read our data, we have preprocessed that, and we have written that. And if we would like to know how we have preprocessed that, that is a different question respect of what we did in our analysis. We can go inside the function. And check what we have done, and also we gain another option that as we have a function, we can start to test it. Maybe if we have found a bug. So keep in mind that writing formal test seems to be time expensive, but always when you try to do when you find a bug or when you try to see if an output of a preprocessing is correct or not, you are always written a test, but you have written them in the console, inside the console. So the issues is not to to have to write other code to test your code. That seems time consuming. But it is simply to know how to test them, and don't waste your time to repeatedly write your test on the console, and also losing those tests once you have seen the results. So the package you can use in your project could be the test that package. So we can install that and from the test pack the test that package we can try to we can start to write some tests. So Control Shift R tests, and the one of the problem, if we would like to say that, of testing is that we have to load the testing package and maybe other packages, and they can interact with our script and with our analysis and with our environment that start with our package. So we don't need the test that package loaded and attached inside our session, but we need it only in when we do the test. For that, there is another package that is automatically installed with the DevTools ones. That is the Wither package, and this create a sort of box in which we can include many different things. One of them is package. So we can use with package, and we can say we would like here to use test that. And inside here, inside this block of code that we will write here, we have the test that package attached. But outside here, the test package is not attached anymore. So now we can use the functionality of the test that package to create a report. So now we have to attach it to use them. But after that, with Control Shift F10, we restart our session and we have a clean execution of our analysis. So with the reporter, we can use the default reporter. And inside here, we can test that. We can use the test that functionality. So here we simply have to say what we want to test. So for example, reproc returns expected number of calls, for example. And one thing that we have found useful is to divide the test in three main stages. One is the setup of the test. One is the evaluation of our code. And finally is the actual test we want to provide. So to test that, the preproc, we need an instance of DBRow. And oh, keep in mind that everything that happened inside the test set live and died inside the test set. So we can do whatever we want here, that outside of the test, our environment is kept clean. So reader, it's CSV.
Corrado, we are 30 minutes from the end of the session.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, now we go with the evaluation and we have our DB, reproc DB row. And at the end, we can have our actual test and call DB expect equal 4. So if we run this code, from the beginning, Control Shift F10. So we have our version, our packages, our function, and when we run our test, test. Okay. When we run our test, we say that all the tests we have now just one, is run and it is passed. But as you can see outside, we don't have the DB object, we don't have the DB row object. And if we explore our package stack, we don't have the tested package inside our environment. So everything here is kept isolated for everything from everything else. Okay, so as always, we should always try to make a mistake. So to see if the test correctly tested for our interest. And so, as we can say, if I have removed one variable, and that is, so the result is 3 and not 4, the test correctly is failing. Okay. So now we have also our tested. So one thing that you can point at this moment is that clearly this is a so this is a quite horrible and confusing script. So maybe if we have arrived at this moment, so we have repeated our code and we would like to extract we would like to use function to encode the repeated code. If we would like to extract function to use different level of abstraction when we read our code. If we have found bugs and we face ourselves in making tests and we write tests to be sure to not repeat every time all the tests we have already produced. All of that is quite confusing if we arrive that at this point in the same script. So maybe now we can need some little structure that can be useful, and for that we can simply activate a quite powerful functionality of RStudio that is a functionality of RStudio and DevTools packages and other utility package that is to have a description file. This is created. You can create that using the use this package. So use this. Use description. The use this package is automatically installed by the DevTools package. Is a part of that, and the description file is simply a file that is characteristics of R package development. We are not interested in developing R package. But the wonderful things is that if we have a description file correctly formatted as used this could do, we activate all the functionalities of the R package development, even if we are not developing a package. The only thing we have to care about is that the packages must have they have a specific naming convention, but we can avoid to check on that convention. So we can name our project as we would like, simply using the check name option false to use description. So if we run this this line of code. In a moment, we we have our description file. I do not to open it because it doesn't matter on our interest what it is inside of that. If you would like to go deeper on that, you can open this description file, look how it is structured, complete the fields that are inside, but we don't need it. We simply need to have it inside our project. So once we have our description file here, we can activate all the testnet utilities, for example. So for example, use this, use testnet, and we can simply do that, and everything is created for us. We have the test folder, and we have the testnet folder, the test R script, and inside here, we will go our test. But even that, we don't need to know anything about that, because we simply use other functionalities that are, for example, use this user to create functions in script that contain functions in the correct position. So we can have functions. And as you can see, it automatically creates the R folder and the function script inside. We can use whatever name we want. And automatically, if we use this use test function, it automatically creates a test function script correctly named, correctly put in the right folder. At every time, even if I close all of them and I rerun user functions, it will open exactly the same file. And if I run use testnet function, it opens exactly the same file. So we can extract and put all our functions inside the function script, for example, and we can put our test without all the machinery of Wither and Wither Reporter, simply the test. So it is even simpler inside the test function. That said, we can remove all those sections that we added earlier. And we now simply have to load our function. So we can here source here function. Okay. So that we have all of our function inside our script. We can put a two here if we would like to. What happened? Why my keyboard doesn't work? Just a moment. What is the name of this? I don't know what is happening. Some suggestion? I have did some strange thing. Why doesn't work the keyboard? Okay. Sorry, I shut down just a moment our studio because I don't know what happened. Okay. So we have our analysis. Okay. I don't know what was happened. Okay, so we can put the two here. And this way we can, oh, Rand has something to say. Okay. We have this different version of packages, and we have not record these files that it is used but not recorded. So can snapshot them. Yes. Control shift at 10. Okay. So now we can do our analysis. Control all return. As you can see, we have saved another version of our data. We have saved all the version of our output, but our report still be the updated one and the same one in our case. Okay, but so we correctly load all our functionalities, but if we attach the library DevTools, we can have with the Control Shift T, we can automatically run all our tests that is failing. Now we see why, but we automatically run all our tests. And take a look in why we failed, because we cannot find the select function inside the preproc. And in fact, if we go to the function file inside the preproc, the clean names and the select names doesn't use the janitor package expression and the dplyr package expression. We don't see this error before, because we execute our test inside the analysis script after we have attached those packages. So while our environment for testing is isolated to the outside environment, it's not isolated inside from the outside. So we have now to put a janitor, and we have to put dplyr. And simply pressing Control Shift T, we automatically run the test. The good things about that is that with only a single key press of three keys, we are able to automatically run all the tests we have written. All the tests we have written, and we need to write them only once. We don't need to rewrite them on the console to check the result every time. And we run all of them every time. So even if we change something that we don't expect that it would break some other functionalities, we always run all the tests, even the one that we don't think that are relevant. So this is a very powerful tools to save a lot of times, because we will always break something, and this way we automatically fix check our function. Okay, so that said, we can go on the further stage. And now we can start to think about data. What if we would like to have we need to have data that are kept secure and hidden from the outside, but that we can keep able that we need to be able to show our code. We can use we can use environmental variable to automatically detect where our data is stored. To have our environmental variable, we can again use and use these functionalities, and in particular we can use Arenviron. No, edit, sorry, edit. Arenviron. But we would like to have environmental variable only at the project level, so project. And in the same time, my suggestion is to put them inside a group of code, because in the same time, we want to use this to keep it private without any risk. So use it, ignore. Punto .rnviron. Okay, so this way, and this come this git ignore and the question that some of you made me before, to have this environmental variable that have secrets inside, so the real path in which are stored the data, or maybe some token or some password, or some other kind of credential or secret in general. If we track this file with Git, we can we have a high risk of disclose our secrets. So usually, so keeping those two lines inside the same block of code, we force to automatically run them at the same time. And inside the git ignore, that is simply a list of files that are not tracked by Git inside our project, we add the correct line of code inside, so the git ignore. So we are safe to put all our secrets inside our environment. So this way, for example, we can put a variable, for example, data row path, and we can have data path, and we can have output path variable, and maybe we can use a secret path that could be, I can put it everywhere in my computer outside the project folder. For example, I put it inside my project in maybe in a private space here, and I can copy the other one. Or maybe I also can create them. So for example, inside our project, we have private space and we have data row and output. And here we have our raw data that are completely outside of our project. And we have our, so I can delete, this is a previous run. I can delete everything. Okay, so now I need a way to use those information, and the way we can access to them is by the using of function sysgetend. So if we restart our session, and the Arenviron variables are loaded. Yes, because when we start the session, the first things that will be executed is the R environ, and the variables are stored inside R memory for our session. Next, the R profile will run. That is the R script that we see below before. And after that, we can assess iteratively, or we can use or execute code in our session. So here, if we use sysgetm and we name one of the variable that we would like to have, we get its content. The problem is that if we use this directly, we can show it on the console, or maybe we can store them inside an object, and we don't want to do that. So we can create some functions that give us the option to get those variables. So we can use this. So maybe we can create some utilities. So use this user utils, and we can use this use test utils. So we can execute those function, and automatically inside our R folder appears the utilities function, and inside the test that appear the test for the utilities. So here we can now put our function to get the environmental variable. So for example, we can use get data row path function. And maybe we would like to go in a subfolder of our hidden private folder, but maybe not. So we can use file path to define correctly our path. Sys getm, and we have data row path, and can use.
Okay, Corrado, we are in the last 10 minutes of the regular session.
Okay, thank you. Sub. Normalized path is useful to have path working on different systems. And we need to explain if we want that the file already exists or not. So if we make must work true, it means that the file, and in the row data, in the data row case, we want that the file is there or get an error. On the other two options, so for the data and the output, we possibly don't have the object that we want to create. So we don't need, we need must work equal false. So let me just copy paste that, and here we can have data must work false, and here we have output. False. So we can also create some tests. I have already created them, just because I'm quite late in time, I copy pasted them. So I create a test just to explain if the directory exists, and if the source to check if it reaches the files, and if I get an error if the file doesn't exist in the case of raw data, and the same for the other. Keep in mind that just with the control shift T, I have all the tests run there, and maybe I have all my tests with error or passing. I get an error because with test I use another package that extend the functionality of testnet, including other expectation that is checkmate. Okay, and you can put, just to let you know, you can put a particular R file here that is named simply setup inside the test folder, testnet setup. And this script is run first before all the test is run. So here we can library checkmate, for example, and so now possibly everything should work okay because all the functions were found. Okay, so now that we have all our structure, there is still the last option and opportunity to improve. So it still remain the issues that inside our report we have load the object we have created with our analysis script, but there is nothing that guarantee the automatically linked from the execution of the analysis and the fact that the report markdown load exactly those results. So we know that everything is inside the same everything is inside the same project, and so it is quite good, but it is not a guarantee. Moreover, there is the issues that we don't have a clear connection between what we have to execute if we change something. So we don't have an automatic way to create new object only if we need to update those object, and we don't have a direct link with what we have created and what we load in our report. So for that we can use the target targets package, and just to let you know, so we can here add the targets. Okay, keep in mind that even if you spend a lot of time the first time to install those packages with Rend environment, only the first time you install the package you spend time. As you can see, in half a second I have installed the target package, and also you can use target types that expand the functionalities of targets. So this way we can simply use targets and use targets is as simple as that, and everything is already set up for us. So it is created the main script that is already opened there with some useful instruction. And there are also another folder that it is hidden from here that is that manage all the machinery of targets. We have go out of time just to show you the final results. I keep this project here that I took. The only difference is that in the target script, I put all the calling function here, and every function get a name with the target. As you can see, I have created object that I give a name to object that are created using one of the function we have defined. We have linked we have also created a link with our report. With our report, and we can create a function that save versioned our versioned object. This way, we can simply call start. And here you say that you have all the graph of the pipeline you have created with all the function and all the objects you have created up to the final report, and you see if something had to rerun. And in that case, you simply tar run. Where it is? Run script, tar make, sorry, not tar run. I'm with the late. and with this, everything is executed only if it is required to be executed. And you have exactly in your report, you read exactly those objects. And so you have created a perfect link of what you have executed and run it, and what you have loaded inside your record. Okay, to answer the question, yes, you can reuse the code as you want inside, and also to wrap up everything. You can reuse all our code, and you can share with colleagues our repository, and also we have already, so if you know that you need all of that, we have provided a comprehensive template that is here at our unit GitHub account that is Lime's analysis, that is a template that you can simply push the button use template on GitHub, and you have all of we have talked about today, and you gain some functionality, added functionalities. And I hope also to have included some good instruction to how to use and automatically configure the project using the template. Quite everything should be easy to use. Please open issues if you find that it is not something that it is not clear. Okay, just to to conclude, start easily, slow, but keep in mind that you want to have a final result that is good. And don't be high speed, so not as soon as possible, because if your results are wrong, all your speed goes down to zero. And keep in mind that the bugs will be there, and the greatest error you can do is to assume your code is going to be error-free. And do and check only what you really need to do and check. And use standard and coherent style to make everything invisible. So the incredible power of all of this structure, if you use it as a template, as soon as you use it in 3, 5, 10 projects, everything become invisible, because this is a lot of stuff, but you know exactly when to look and to see some folder or some script. And when I know that I want to go to some function, I go here. Everything else disappears. Only the R folder, I see only the R folder. And here is the report. The tests are all there. So the important things to have coherent style, standard, and templates are making things invisible. That is the most powerful characteristics of standards and template. And that save your time. So these are just the technical recap of what we have done. And even if you don't use our template, if you find yourself to always use many structure and many convention, create your own template, and go for as soon as possible, considering the project time. Okay, so thank you. I hope that I would be clear and maybe useful. Remember that it is true that the best is the enemy of the good, but the only way to go faster is to go well. This is our two sentences for Voltaire and Uncle Bob that is with me across all my project and journey on my research activity. Okay, so thank you. Please write to both of us for any question, any suggestion, every requirements of improvement for our templates. Give us feedback, and keep in mind that our purpose as tools are not written on the stone and are not and they don't need to be shared. So if you would like to use testnet, use testnet, or if you would like to use other things, use other things. So keep in mind only the process of create a project and maintain it across the time. Okay, so
if I can give a quick final remark, it's a lot to process, it is true, but once you start to use them, it goes along really easily, like to follow everything and to have everything well organized. As that even I did a new computer science, I studied medicine, and I didn't have so much problems implementing it in my research projects. So I think that's quite a pro of this approach, like to combine everything at a point where the learning curve goes kind of flat, and it's really easy to take up on those kind of libraries that fit so well together.
Yes, thank you, Andrea. And another thing, remember that it is quite a lot, but you don't need to use all of that stuff every time. Use only what you really need, and from the moment you need it afterwards. And if you know in advance that you need all of that stuff, don't implement it. Use a template. So spend time the first time or the second time to create your own template, or to adapt a template you find from other with your needs and use a template. And all of that lot of stuff disappear because you have quite one click away from a completely correctly set up project. And if you don't need all of them, don't implement them. So start, if you have only a single script and you have only to run a single execution, do only that. But keep in mind that every time that you add something, how that something could be maintained in the future with changes and implement a little structure that can be maintained step by step, one time that you add functionalities. We have finished.